Welcome, welcome to The Nose. Today on The Nose, a little bit later, we'll have a conversation that is triggered by some tweets subsequently deleted by Donald Glover about cancel culture. That may be the most slender premise for a conversation. I mean, the tweets have been sort of pounced on by other people and written about, but it's, you know, it's a slender beginning. Anyway, it's three tweets. Also, a piece by Amanda Hess, a good friend of ours and frequent appearer on the show back in the day, about Sinead O'Connor. Maybe somebody you haven't thought about for a while, but she's been thinking. I mean, Sinead O'Connor has been thinking a lot about Sinead O'Connor, so... she wants to let you know what she's been thinking. But we're going to begin with The Underground Railroad, the Barry Jenkins adaptation of the acclaimed Colson Whitehead novel, which just scooped up bushels of literary awards. And Jenkins's adaptation runs on Amazon Prime. It's 10 episodes. Uses, as did Whitehead's novel, the techniques of magical realism to tell a very different story, or perhaps not a very different story, about slavery and its consequences. So joining us to do all of that today, we are very excited to have Tanisha Dugan, artistic producer at TheaterWorks, and Rich Holland, a principal at CoLab, founder of the Free Center, more about that in a few minutes, and commissioner on cultural affairs for the city of Hartford. So before I get them going, let's hear a little clip. You're going to hear really kind of the two of the principals here, Aaron Pierre as Caesar and Tuso Mbedu as Cora. This is from episode one, chapter one, Georgia.
Cora, will you come with me? It is past time to go. There is nothing here but suffering, pain, and suffering.
You're wrong about me, Caesar. You think I'm some kind of luck because my mama got away, but you're wrong. You're wrong. I ain't no kind of luck. The only kind I have was rotten. The kind that caused a woman to run away in the middle of the night and leave her only child. Leave her to bleed and rot on this damn plantation. Is that the kind of luck you're looking for?
I'm not supposed to be here.
Where are you?
That's two slaves. I think that's pretty obvious, Cora and Caesar. If you read the book, you know a little bit more about their backstories and a little bit more about what they're referring to. But they are both talking about running away from the plantation where they're living. And I think it's not much of a spoiler to say that is what they do. So let's just talk a little bit about this. As I say, we have Tanisha Dugan and Rich Holland, two of our regular and much cherished panelists here to talk about this. So, Rich Holland, I'm going to start with you. First of all, you did something that I now realize probably we shouldn't try to do, which is you watched a lot of episodes of this. Now that I've seen some of the Underground Railroad, I sort of realize I should have given us like 2 weeks so that we could go a little bit more slowly, because this is not something that I at least am finding particularly easy to quote unquote binge.
No, it was brutal. It was brutal and traumatic and, you know, I don't really particularly like the word triggering, but it was, you know, uber triggering. Maybe it was the pace at which I viewed it, and I do want to slap Amazon on the wrist for not being more thoughtful in how they release these things.
Mm-hmm.
But it captured a kind of unnecessary to me darkness. And it raised suffering to a point of where content gets stripped from it, and what you're left with is a conversation about vulgarity, and that to me is a gigantic disservice to the tale of the Underground Railroad. It is the gigantic disservice to the possibility of triumph over oppression. And I think quite a few missteps were here, while also tremendously seductive. The faces in this movie are, you know, are portraits I could look at all day long.
Yes, and by the way, I don't know if you've seen this or are aware of it, but if you want to do something along those lines, Barry Jenkins has released a thing called The Gaze, which is 52 minutes of more of the kind of these background actors or some of the actors who are not, you know, prominently featured. But it's just one by one them looking for prolonged periods of time right into the camera while a special score composed by, is it Nicholas Cretel? I forget who wrote the music for this thing, is playing in the background. It's you wouldn't think you, and nobody says anything, you know, and you wouldn't think you could watch that for 52 minutes, but you could.
Fascinating, Colin, because I think that would be like, now that is a story, right? Yeah. You know, that is a story of humanity and what's captured and locked in every last one of us, you know, and why we are equal and why we deserve to resolve, you know, all of this horrendous stuff that's happened in the past, right? That's a story that's rich and deep.
Okay, I want to come back to some of the stuff you said, but I want to hear from Tanisha, too. I think Rich was suggesting that maybe Amazon would have been better served by following more of the HBO model, where you drop one of these episodes a week and give people a kind of a chance to chew on it instead of trying to plow through these things, which does get to be, I think, pretty traumatic. But Tanisha, just interested, I know a little bit about what your reactions are from pre-show conversations, but where are you right now?
I'm glad we started with the like do not binge watch warning, because I think that's really important. And I also feel like if WandaVision can be released week to week, I think we can do this here. I agree wholeheartedly with everything Rich has said. You know, Barry Jenkins is an auteur, right? His filmmaking is stunning. I think the landscapes and the faces and the beauty that he's extracting from sort of the world is, you know, that is what he does. And so kudos. But I think for me, as a culture maker and a believer that culture not only tells the story of where we are, but where we're going. And as somebody, I said this to you all, who bought the book because, you know, it was something that smart people were reading, but never opened it because I now know it was not meant for me. I'm curious about our obsession with this particular time period. I think what it does for Black people is it reaffirms a placement in this hierarchy. And I think what it does for white people is it reaffirms their placement in this hierarchy. And so, you know, when Rich said that we are equal, I said, well, essentially, yes. But I think we know as Americans, that's not true. That Rich and I are different, that Rich and I have to move differently than you do, Colin. And while I look forward to the last two episodes, because apparently those are the ones in which redemption feels more palpable. For me, the project remains a status quo interpretation of who we are as Americans. And I'm not sure if containing the brutality of whiteness and white supremacy within this time period actually tells the American story of its very long tentacles that reach out till today. And so that's where I am with it now, but I'm going to give it a break and come back to the last four episodes, because I kind of half watched the seventh episode and see where I come to. But that's where I am today.
So I would like just to explore this with both of you. I think, I don't mean to speak for Colson Whitehead or Barry Jenkins, but I think if one of them were here, and this is a little bit based on some reading too, I think what they would say is, yeah, I mean, the point ultimately of this, if it could be said to have one point, is that in some ways it's meant to kind of upend the standard kind of timeline of slavery as a thing that existed and then, you know, was dealt with and then went away. You know, that in a way the narrative of this work is about its black characters negotiating a series of different arrangements, each one of which kind of turns out to be something of a repetition of what they were dealing with before. In other words, that the idea of escape is an illusion, you know, again and again, that this sort of, you know, and I don't know, this in a way that kind of sounds like what both of you got. Well, particularly you, what I heard you just say, Tanisha. I mean, I don't know. I think the auteurs would probably say, yeah, right? I mean.
Right. And so I would say, and what for? Right. Because if you don't come out, you, Colin, don't come out of this saying, oh, I see the ways in which people, black and brown people, negotiate their interactions with me. And how do I make that better moving forward? It just underlines what we know to be true, what we may not speak about, but what we know to be in the air of American discourse. So I'm not sure that the exclamation point around what exists actually moves us forward. And I'm much more interested in moving us forward because we've been having a similar conversation for 60 years, right? Mm-hmm. I said, you know, over the weekend, I said to my uncle, you know, 2021 is kind of like 1963. And he was like, I don't know about that. And I was like, actually, you got to sit down and really reckon with the fact that that is true. Because if we keep saying there is a kind of progress that's happening, to me, it's like the museum. To me, it's like South Carolina. To me, it's like, yes, you have the image of appropriated middle-class black people, but underneath that is the same story of ones that are not. So for me, it's about what does it do? What did it do to you, Colin? What did it do for audiences like you? Did it move the needle for you in a way that made you go, oh, wow, that's happening right now. That's in the seeds of what I'm doing today. Or did you go, oh, yeah, well, then that is how it was. And I'm not sure the connections are being made.
Yeah, I mean, I would say that I the way that I interpret it, I mean, it is that that Whitehead and Jenkins are saying that, yeah, I mean, if you've lived through 2020 or any recent year and have seen what has happened here, what has happened to black people in America on a daily basis, on a weekly basis, the body count, the humiliation, the macroaggression, the microaggression, it doesn't really make any sense not to connect that to the fallen origin story. So yeah, I mean, in a way, part of my takeaway, I mean, I haven't finished this series yet either, but part of my takeaway is yeah, we didn't really fix stuff. We renamed it, we made it better, but I mean, nothing's fixed. And I mean, I kind of knew that without their help, but it drives it home. It drives the point home. So yeah, go ahead.
So the challenge with that for me, Colin, is like, absolutely. So we the folks who are going to get that already know that, right? You know, the folks who aren't going to get that, this movie's not going to get them any closer to it. This movie's going to provide them an out, you know, and provide them an out that says that, you know what? I did not just whip and burn a black man for literally 20 minutes on their computer screen. So I'm okay. You know, I'm not that monster, you know, and that out is being provided by that movie, by the scale to which they raised these atrocities and made them visceral and visible, right? And it also did a couple of things that got under my skin. I think you might hear it in my voice right now. Got under my skin, right? It's this almost to the point of, you know, this way of treating black bodies and this sort of willingness to explore brutality on black bodies that is prevalent in movie making and storytelling right now. This violence against Black people that's being demonstrated, shown over and over and over and over again, to greater extents, to deeper, that the challenge here isn't telling the story in a new way, but the challenge is how far can we go with the depiction of this brutality? When you match that in the movie with the times that white people were at the hands of these oppressors, at the hands of these supremacists, you know, their deaths happen either off screen, you know, or it's like the old Western way of a single bullet in the back and you don't actually even see anything that happens, you know, yet the suffering that's depicted levied onto Black bodies, it's an insanity. And, you know, and I can't wrap my head around the why. It doesn't make the story any more real.
And what concerns me is that these are the kinds of films by Black filmmakers that are funded, because I think about this with Queen and Slim as well, right? Lena Waithe's project, whose idea was actually germinated by a white man, but that's a whole nother discussion for another day. It is interesting to me that the things that get greenlit continue this narrative in our culture, which is why I say, you know, I want to wait until episodes 9 and 10, because perhaps there is a map for what is next. But I'm not hopeful that is what culture makers at the highest levels are interested in. I actually think that they're very much interested in keeping us where we are, and then making us excited for the beauty of the product, a la this Underground Railroad or Queen and Slim, but keeping us from actually having the conversation that, you know, we are engaging with today, Rich, which is, what does it mean to regurgitate the brutality of Black bodies that you can easily see on the internet, on your evening news, on your cable news, if that's something that is of your liking? What does it do to continue to tell that story in art form? And I think art, you know, I think I'm stealing this from an article I read in preparation for this, right? Is the brother of public education, right? Its work is to move us. Its work is to teach us. Its work is to add context to the things that we are learning as a collective. And right now we are supporting the anti-critical race theory conversation. Right now we're supporting, you know, while it looks like the 1619 Project, it actually doesn't track beyond that. I don't know how many versions of Roots we need.
Exactly. It all feels like the same movie. Yeah. It all feels like the same movie with, you know, slightly better with increasingly better technology and increasingly better, increasingly more challenges to what the audience is allowed to sit through from a censorship level.
Is the article that you read the one by Scott Woods by any chance? Because I do, The Beast in the Times, yeah. And I mean, oddly enough, he kind of comes down in a really different place from you guys, though. I mean, he's actually
to find a Black critic to read.
Yeah.
Because I needed some context around the rave reviews. Don't get me wrong. I think this project should win all the Emmys. I think the actress whose name I don't want to slaughter, so I won't say it, deserves all the flowers. Mm. And also, where are my Black critics giving me the context I need to receive this? And I don't need Oprah, who I love dearly, but who is going to say with Harry and Meghan, she doesn't understand colorism, which is a flat out lie. Mm-hmm. We know this to be true. So she is not my preferred witness. She is not the best for this, right? Not to mention the fact that it was on her book list. And so I think her connection and wanting for this to be a blockbuster sits in a different place. I need some Black critics to tell me where they sit with this project. And so far, what most people are saying is, don't binge.
Yeah.
Don't binge it. And it's beautiful.
Right. I mean, it was just interesting. And I'm only saying this to say that different sets of eyes can see things in a very different way. I mean, Woods, who's been very specifically critical in other pieces of exactly the thing that you're talking about, Rich, this kind of fetishization of the violence on the Black body, I mean, singled out this thing for not doing that. And I just do wonder, I mean, we're going to have to wrap this up pretty soon. You know, for black auteurs, whether it's Whitehead or Jenkins, are they kind of damned if they do or damned if they don't? I mean, if they don't confront the reality of this in pretty visceral ways, people are going to say, well, now you're glossing over it. Or, to your point, Rich, if they show white people suffering at a comparable level of violence to black people, are they going to be criticized for engaging in false equivalence? I mean, I'm wondering if there is any way to thread this particular needle if you're going to undertake the project at all.
Maybe we don't need to undertake the project for a while until we move a little further.
Mm-hmm.
When I start looking at the overwhelming amount of the overwhelming critical reviews that I read about this that lifts up ideas like traumatic, unflinching, and relentless, is that really what we need to? Is that all that this thing needs to be? You know, has that become the new standard of excellence?
Yeah, you know, fair question. Fair question. Okay. Yeah.
Or black storytelling.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think we can all agree. Barry Jenkins, I mean, we haven't seen that many movies so far. He's still really, for somebody who's kind of early in his career right now, he's an amazing director. And what he's been able to do, I mean, this is a complicated thing, taking Whitehead's work, which has a certain kind of texture, which has a certain kind of narrative style to it, which supplies a lot of details that you can't supply in a movie, to do it, I think, pretty successfully. The translation of this, using... obviously different kinds of techniques than what an author does. I'm super impressed anyway. I mean, we can go back and forth about whether this is anything anybody should have to endure. But as art, I think it shows a pretty impressive. I don't know. I would watch any movie this guy made.
As art, it is stunning, right? It is stunning. The director, the photography, the sort of the choice, the visual choices, the way in which he gives us the hints of magical realism throughout this is beautiful. It's beautiful. And also, it is difficult when you are an artist not to want to get the things, not to want to win the Pulitzer, not to want to get the Oscar, not to want to get the shiny medals. And that comes with a sacrifice. That too. Is part of this dance that they talk about within this miniseries. Does it need to be made? Did it need to be written? I don't know. And yet we understand how to capture the dominant culture's imagination and how we can use that to further ourselves. I mean, I think of Homer, I think that's the young boy's name, right? And I think of the choice that character makes as a 7-year-old or 8-year-old to find his own individual success no matter what. And my question is, do we have the capacity after 400 years of the kind of brutality that we saw witnessed in this miniseries, do we have the capacity to actually serve as martyrs and sacrifices to the future legacy that isn't about what I can win today, about the flowers I received today, but the sacrifice I can make so that the one sitting here 60 years from now isn't having this conversation with you.
Yeah, hopefully not. All right. Well, that's a pretty good bridge to where we're going in the next segment. So maybe we'll stop there. By the way, I hunted around until I found a clip of her saying her own name. And so I'm pretty confident that it's Tuso Mbedu. She's a South African actress, really hasn't been in a lot of stuff. And what a, as Rich said, the faces in this movie are pretty incredible. And what the story they just tell with their faces. All right, let's take a break. The Underground Railroad is what we've been talking about.
One, two, three. Yeah, it's my national underground thunderbolts, and I stop the ground like a million elephants, a silverback orangutan. You can't stop a train. Who wants some? Don't come unprepared. I'll be there, but when I leave there, better be a household name. Brother man telling us it ain't gonna rain. So now we sit in a drop top soaking wet, in a silk suit trying not to sweat. Hit somersaults without the net, but this be the year that we won't forget. 1999.
And this is The Nose. With us today, Tanisha Dugan, artistic producer at TheaterWorks, Rich Holland, principal at CoLab, founder of Free Center and commissioner on cultural affairs for the city of Hartford. And speaking of Free Center, Rich, I know you wanted to mention a couple of things going on with that.
Yeah, there are two things that are going on at Free Center. You could find them at freecenter.us. They are the top two graphics, and you could just jump right in. One of them, we're holding a two exhibitions, one in our Middletown space and in Hartford simultaneously, and it's called Black Period. It's portraits of Black people by Black people, including the elusive self-portrait. And that show will be traveling when we're wrapped up here in Connecticut to our new Free Center opening up in Baltimore this summer. Along with that, through the Artists of Color United advisory group that advises the Hartford Foundation for Public Giving, we have at Free Center received $150,000 to put money to create art in the hands of independent BIPOC artists using the simplest possible ungrant looking process. It's five questions about you, five questions about your project. And if you're a Greater Hartford independent BIPOC artist, you'll pre-qualify for funding from $2,000 to $20,000 to pay yourself first to do your work.
All right. So those are good. And kind of, you know, thematically tied to what we're talking about here today, I think, in some interesting ways, too. So speaking of thematically tied, this is an interesting thing. I'll just sort of lift the curtain for a second and say it's usually pretty hard to get us all to agree about what we're going to talk about. But we did really, really easily today find two topics that we wanted to talk about. One of them are three tweets by Donald Glover, in which he subsequently got rid of, but he said, saw people on here having a discussion about how tired they were of reviewing boring stuff, TV and film. We're getting boring stuff and not even experimental mistakes because people are afraid of getting canceled. So they feel like they can only experiment with aesthetic. Also because some of them know they're not that good. He then deleted the tweets, but this started a conversation. So I don't know, Tanisha, help us understand, first of all, why did you pounce on this as something you wanted to talk about?
Because I'm always talking about how I hate cancel culture and then also like walking it back and saying, I don't mean it in the ways that some folks mean it over at Fox News. I mean it in the way of truly like squashing both experience and creativity. Mainly the experience piece because I teach at the college level, and I'm fascinated by their inability to interface with anything that they have never interfaced with before. And I'm always curious about how one gets through life like that, because life is just not like that. I also think about it in terms of like the pandemic, and while everyone is feeling housed in by what the pandemic has brought to them, I think because of my epigenetics, I am built in a way that sees the opportunity in the trauma, in the tragedy, in the things that are less than forgiving. And I think that like cancel culture kind of works against a kind of resilience that is like essentially human if you're going to make it through this rock. So that's, I think that's why I am jumping on it, because I feel like, one, now that Black people are talking about it in a different way, I think it it hits different because what we're offering is not about safety, because we have no expectation of that, right? What we're talking about is full agency and the ability to kind of try anything, even if it's gonna mess it up, you know, because you can ask for forgiveness. Like, you can mess up and then be like, "Ooh, I did that thing."
Right. Well, and the point of cancel culture, as it is frequently exercised, is you can't ask for forgiveness, or exactly. You can ask for it, you won't get it. We should say that we also read a piece by Alex Miller, who jumped on these piece, on these tweets for a piece in The Independent. And I keep saying jumped on because, like, Glover wrote them. They sort of feel like kind of thoughts that he's still forming. And then he erased them, too. So I'm...
Cancel culture.
Yeah. Well, no, I'm just thinking, you know, so he's got Miller's pieces. Donald Glover is right. I'm sick of white people canceling things on my behalf. I mean, his level of confidence that he knows what Donald Glover thinks is higher than mine anyway. But I mean, there's obviously the beginning of a conversation here. So yeah, Rich, give us your thoughts.
So what was fascinating about this for me is that I haven't been, over the past year, I have not been thinking of cancel culture as a binary thing, as a cancel or don't cancel, right? It's about the conversation around cancel that I find far more interesting than the actual canceling itself. You know, so what actually gets a pass, you know? And where is there somewhere in this a line that we could eventually define that says like, okay, this is when you cross it, you know? Folks who tend to agree with me, I think don't need to be canceled as much, right? and so there's this peculiarity of you know, even how this is negotiated, right? And when I take a look at the article in The Independent, which I think is a worthy read because I also found it to be somewhat problematic, is as he started looking at some of the concerns around you know, what we say and how we say it, it came down to who we convince, you know, who we bring along. And there was this concern about that some stuff that we could be putting out there is just never going to be, you know, acceptable to a right-wing audience. And so we need to give some thought to what we say, as though that kind of persuasion is really what we're working toward.
Yeah, I feel like it's important to sort of have some kind of... I thought Miller's piece was kind of short on specifics, mm-hmm. like specific examples. So, you know, I mean, we have situations where somebody turns out to have some fairly repellent ideas and we just didn't know that. Gina Carano from The Mandalorian would be an example of that. But when I think of cancel culture, when I read about it, most of what I'm reading about is, you know, you can't cancel Jordan Peterson. You can't cancel Donald Trump. You can't cancel people whose base of power already exists within essentially a right-wing world that already applauds them for saying the stuff that they're saying. You can only cancel people who are much closer to you ideologically, center-left, which is why maybe somebody like J.K. Rowling, you know, faces, I mean, you can't cancel her either. She's the best-selling author of all time. But you know, to me, that's one of the things that I don't think Miller explored I mean, the people who are worried, the people that Glover's talking about who are worried, they're not conservatives. They're center-left people who feel like they're going to make a mistake, right?
Well, I mean, it's you. First of all, you can't cancel people who refuse to go away. So I don't think that Trump as the example of a potential recipient of cancel culture is actually appropriate.
Right.
Because
but Miller did make that example. I thought it was a bad example.
No, he did not make that example. But I also think that cancel culture is first of all, the word and the idea is a framing for right wings to hurl at liberals. So there's that, right? And I think that liberals tend to be the most effective in canceling their own people. I think of, I can't remember his name right now, you guys will fill it in, representative from Minnesota, old comedian on SNL.
Al Franken.
Thank you, Al Franken, who I think we all would say, we as a collective canceled him, right? But like, was that really the right move for the legacy, right? For where we actually want to go? I think the rights activities would tell you that not canceling the worst of them is a part of their legacy, is a part of the trajectory they want to be on. I think this is a specifically liberal issue, a white liberal issue, which is why I think that article rang so true for me, because it is about white liberals trying really hard not to step in something. And I have witnessed places where wonderful white liberals have apologized to me for things that I just think to myself, really? Really?
But that's to Rich's point about where the line is, right? I mean, I think a lot of what we're seeing, and maybe we're on a kind of a shakedown cruise here, but I think there's a lot of people who don't, you know, it's hard to figure out. For example, two journalists, one of whom I know pretty well, have been really kind of effectively canceled because they engaged in conversations about whether journalism should ever actually say the N-word in order to report it, to cite it, to make a point. In other words, do you say that Mark Furman said the N-word, or do you actually say the word that Mark Furman said? And in one case, this is a guy who used the word in talking to students about why the word's objectionable. But speaking the word out loud seems to have, in the case of Don McNeil in the New York Times, and Mike Pesca, who I think was mainly engaged in conversations about whether that maybe journalists should sometimes actually say the word. They're neither one of them is in their old position anymore. And I wouldn't have known beforehand that that's where the line was, particularly like good intentions, which I think both of them had, were not enough in that particular situation. And to me, Rich, that's if you're sort of saying, where's the line? Yeah, I don't know where the line is. You only know by watching like who gets you know, a yellow card.
But the interesting thing about what you were just stating there, that example, Colin, is I don't believe that it was the discourse that caused the yellow line. Mm. I think that what caused the yellow line is slippery slope thinking, right? You know, it's folks who make every decision looking at, you know, this potential perceived, you know, sometimes fantasy of a slippery slope. You know, it's like, well, if we could say it now in this context that we feel really right about it, you know, what happens when this guy gets a hold of it?
Mm-hmm. You know? Yeah. And that line was drawn from a hierarchical place, mm-hmm. right? Exactly. Like, yeah. Let's be honest. It wasn't, like you said, Rich, it's not from the discourse. And I think part of the reason why I was attracted to this conversation in relationship to Underground Railroad is that, like, this is the thing that we are going to use to stop the way we treat each other. This is the package in which we're willing to have this conversation that feels specifically ridiculous, right? I mean, what are we talking about, right?
But realistically, this is how the Underground Railroad gets made. This is exactly yes. how the Underground Railroad gets made, right? Because they're not going to push the boundary. What they're going to push the boundary is around, you know, this narrow window of what's acceptable. Okay, so violence is acceptable. How much violence is acceptable? But not about the narrative. You know, the challenge is never about, you know, the narrative. You know, anyway, I could, you know, the white mercenary is still the white mercenary. You know, he is still the one that is going to afford Cora her freedom from herself in this story, right? That goes unchecked, and it's delivered in that story in a completely plausible manner, unchecked.
And that's the line between, exactly. you know, the writer who got his job lost because his boss said, oh, slippery slope, and I'm going to decide how free you can be. That is exactly it. That is exactly the connection. And
although, just as sort of historical record, and this because it's something that I followed a lot, and in a lot of these cases, like in the case of the New York Times, it's really the newsroom pressing management saying, we don't like this, and we don't like this at all, and we want you to do something about it. I don't think it's exclusively hierarchical.
But think about the makeup of the newsroom.
Yeah, but I mean, once again, it's often black employees in the newsroom.
That, right? Yeah, tells me that there's still some reckoning okay. that even you have to deal with that reality, right? Mm-hmm. Because that room is made up of people who are afraid of being caught up in the crossfires of cultural missteps, you know?
And, you know, you raised Al Franken a little while ago. My recollection of that story might be a little bit different, you know? But I remember about getting caught up in the crosshairs of this discourse that Al Franken was one of the first that was ready to cancel himself.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Although, I mean, to me also, I'm not, I feel like there's a meaningful distinction between the Me Too movement, in which I would put the Al Franken story, and cancel culture. You know,
I think there's not a meaningful distinction.
Okay.
And I think it's really important that we don't, because part of Me Too and cancel culture intersect. There is a Venn diagram in which those two things exist. And it's not to diminish sexual abuse and patriarchy. It's to really define the weaponization of my personal comfort, right? I mean, this has a Venn diagram with the Karen, you know, narrative.
Yeah, although if you look at the Glover thing that started all this and the Alex Miller thing, this isn't about, oh, well, all my friends are afraid to sexually abuse women now because they're going to get canceled. It's, no, all these people that I know are people who, creators, they're afraid to say certain things, to couch certain arguments in a certain way, to make certain kinds of artistic statements because they feel like they may cross this line that they can't see that well, you know. So to the extent that Glover and Miller are launching us on a conversation, I don't think it's in the Franken direction. I think it's in the other direction.
I think it's the same direction, right? I think it's about what am I allowed to do in this 2021? Yeah. Whether it is, what am I allowed to say? Whether it's, what art am I allowed to make? What jokes can I tell, you know, to sort of lead us down the Chris Rock road? If everything is about a certain kind of safety, as defined by a certain group of people, we are in a world of trouble. And I think we get really dangerous when we try to separate these things that are together, because it allows us to make, I don't want to say excuses, but talk around the very thing that is actually the essential conversation, which is, I get to tell you what you can and cannot do.
Rich.
I get to tell you where your sexual comfort, where my sexual comfort is. You get to tell me where yours is, 100%. But that the world also gets to have a conversation about, or and input and influence about how our overall life trajectories move based on what I say, what I make, what I do, how I've moved, with no prospect of absolution, with no prospect of forgiveness, with no opportunity for me to say, I messed up, show me how to make it better.
Rich, I think you might be getting the last word on this based on the clock.
Okay. My last word on this, it feels like the conversation is about alignment. You know, what will I be associated with? And there's a piece of it that always feels like it's about legacy and canceled culture. Or this idea of cancellation, right? I don't even like calling it a culture. This idea of cancellation, this sort of witch hunting approach, the Salem quality to it, seems to come down to, is this the sword you will die on? Because this is what the epitaph's gonna be. And there's something that I think is incredibly, incredibly dangerous about that. Not just from an arts and culture standpoint, but dangerous in how we can possibly ever heal in a society with that as the overhang for gravitating towards justice.
All right, we're going to stop there. We're going to sort of, unfortunately, we didn't get to the Sinead O'Connor conversation because this was so interesting. But I will recommend that you read Amanda Hess's New York Times profile of Sinead O'Connor. And meanwhile, we'll play one of her songs, which doesn't really make sense in this context anymore.
I never washed these clothes.
All right. I just want to quickly say that the song that we went out with is You Made Me the Thief of Your Heart from the soundtrack to The Name of the Father. And the only reason I'm mentioning this is that in this piece that Amanda Hesby, Sinead O'Connor says this thing about how I guess she was about to go back out on tour or do something, and she didn't realize she didn't know the words to any of her songs, and she went back and kind of reviewed her own catalog and went, wow, this is really good. I really like this stuff. So, but I just sort of had the same experience listening to that. I'm going, wow, I haven't listened to Sinead O'Connor in a long time, and that's kind of a cool song. All right, so I got to thank Kat Pastor. She's here in the studio. She's our technical producer, solving problems all the time. She's a whiz at it. Jonathan McPants is the producer of pretty much all episodes of The Nose, including this one. So thanks to both of them. And Tanisha Dugan and Rich Holland are our panelists today. We're about to make some recommendations. And Tanisha, why don't you get us going with that?
I always forget their recommendations, but I'm going to start with endorsing.
You can call them either thing.
And a belated endorsement to my father who passed away on April 27th. Mm. Thank you, sir, for making me the woman I am and for the legacy that you have delivered to me to exist in this world.
Oh, that's so, I'm so sorry to hear that. I didn't know that and very sorry to hear that.
It is the circle of life. Yeah. And we've all been through a lot of it this year. So I also want to endorse everybody who's dealt with the highs and lows of what life has to offer us. And my final endorsement is the Connecticut Office of the Arts, the Mahaffey Fellowship, in which I was a recipient of, and to the amazing, incomparable, loving Janika Brown Springer, who is a Hartford, who's a daughter of Hartford, East Hartford, actually. But I wanted to speak her name because I am so very proud of what she has done. And thank you for letting me borrow your brother every now and then when I have some sound composition I have to do.
Oh, cool.
So those are my endorsements.
All right, Rich Holland, how about you?
I am rereading two books simultaneously. That's what I've been doing lately. I haven't been reading new books. I've been rereading books that connect to me. One of them, and reading them simultaneously, which is kind of really interesting. It's weird because they're so much about culture. One of them is Edwidge Dandikat's After the Dance, which is about the southern part of Haiti, where I'm from, and her experiences of Carnival, and how incredibly I related to everything that she says, even though I came here when I was 3 years old, right? That culture endures in a beautiful way. There's a chapter in this book that's called How Jesus and Simon Bolivar came to share a house in Jacmel. It's funny, it's heartful and lovely. Simultaneously, I'm reading Banana Yoshimoto's book, Kitchen, and another beautiful, beautiful piece, lyrically written, full of this kind of quirky romanticism that comes from a culture that's unfamiliar to me. So I get to see love and romance and the complexities of food in a completely different way and appreciate it so much more.
Wow. Well, first of all, great endorsing and recommending from both of you. Thank you so much for that. I'll quickly, Rich just made me think of this with it when talking about the Free Center Project. I'm just going to mention the portraiture and art in general of Benny Andrews. Benny Andrews was a dear friend of mine during his lifetime, was part of a generation of black artists, maybe a little bit younger than Jacob Lawrence and Romare Bearden, but kind of positioned somewhere in that cohort. I know the Athenaeum has at least one of his paintings, and there's been some retrospectives recently. And if you just look at some stuff online, I think you'll see some of the power of it. And he was just a beautiful, beautiful person. I love New York Times obituaries, and I'm going to recommend one by Richard Sandomir. They use some of their best writers to write the obituaries. It's the obituary of Spencer Silver, the research chemist at 3M, who inadvertently created the not-too-sticky adhesive that allows Post-it notes to be removed and put back up and stuff like that. He waits way too long to point out that Lisa Kudrow in the Romy and Michelle's high school reunion pretended to be essentially Spencer Silver at her own high school reunion, but that's in there and a lot of other stuff too. All right. So thanks very much to both of our wonderful panelists, Rich and Tanisha. Thanks to everybody who listened, and we'll be back next week.